This is a case of stress urinary incontinence where you can clearly see the bladder neck hypermobility. The urine is being passed as she coughs. Now if you elevate the lateral fornices and when she coughs, the urine does not come out. So this proves a positive Boney's test. For such patients with stress urinary incontinence and bladder neck hypermobility, Birch colpus suspension is a gold standard. An incision is taken in the skin about 1.5 centimeters above the pubic symphysis. The rectus sheath is cut again at the same level about 1 centimeter above the symphysis pubis. So this is a quite a low incision. Once the rectus sheath is cut, the recti, they are separated from the pubic symphysis. Before that, it is better to ligate the inferior epigastric vessels on either sides so that they don't bleed later on. Ligating the inferior epigastric vessel doesn't lead to hampering the blood supply of the abdominal muscles. After ligating the inferior epigastric vessels on both sides, the recti, they are divided from their insertion at the pubic symphysis, so that later on when you suture, it is a suturing of rectus tendon to tendon and not tendon to muscle. This shows the cutting of the muscles right at their insertions, so that you cut the tendon and not the muscle. A cutting cautery can be used for this purpose. This is the Czerny's incision, which gives excellent exposure to the cave of Regis. Now once the cave of Regis is reached, my left hand fingers are in the vagina and elevating the lateral fornix on the left side. You can see clearly that with the right hand I am dissecting using a gauze piece the bladder medially. There you can see the edge of the bladder which has been dissected medially, so that the vaginal wall has been exposed. It is the color which is important. As you can see here clearly, it is the white color of the vagina which distinguishes it from the bladder, which is yellowish. Once the bladder is dissected completely, this vaginal wall is exposed. Here you can see clearly the mobility of the vaginal wall, which is a prerequisite before you do a Birch colpus suspension, so that now you can see that the vagina can be elevated right up to the pectineal ligament. If the vaginal mobility is not there, then this step cannot be done, and then Birch is relatively contraindicated in such patients with SUI. Again, you can clearly appreciate the change in the color. This is very important because if the vagina is not completely, or the bladder is not completely dissected medially, then your suture will go through the bladder and then that can create problem. Now here you can see clearly the bladder edge which is dissected. That is the obturator foramen that was shown. Now this is clearly the bladder edge that can be seen. So that is the bladder edge which has been dissected medially. Now if there is a vein which is bleeding, a small vein can be easily coagulated. Bigger vessels which are bleeding must be underrun using number 10 chromic catgut. Again, the same step has been demonstrated, the mobility of the vagina and how it is elevated. Once it is elevated, you can imagine that this is something like a permanent Boney's test. Now this shows the level at which a suture has to be taken. Now that is the bladder neck, that is nothing but the Foley's balloon. At that level exactly you have to take the suture through the vagina. If you take the suture too high, it does not effective. If it is too low, it can cause obstruction to the urinary flow. So you can see using number 1 proline, one goes at the level of bladder neck through the entire thickness of the vaginal wall, taking care not to injure your finger which is elevating the vagina. A single mattress suture is sufficient, taking about 1 centimeter length of the vagina and full thickness of the vagina. You can see this is the first suture. Using traction, you can take the second suture easily lateral to the first suture. There it is. So this is the second part of the mattress suture going through the entire wall of the vagina. That's why it is important that the bladder should be dissected completely. So you are including only the vagina and the vaginal fascia. It is mandatory to take the entire vaginal wall. If you take it very superficially, it cuts through. Now you can see how the vagina is being elevated with the proline sutures. This must be tied properly so that it will act as hemostatic suture and also it will promote more fibrosis. Now once the sutures are tied to the vagina, the other end goes through the pectineal ligament. Now this is the pectineal ligament. It is about 4 to 5 centimeters lateral to the pubic symphysis. It is a very tough structure and therefore it gives excellent support to the vagina. You have to take appropriate thickness of the pectineal ligament. Again, it should not be too superficial, otherwise the sutures will cut through. Now you see the complete elevation of the vagina right up to the pectineal ligament. Since the vaginal mobility was there, this step was possible. If the mobility is not there, then some people do what is called as vagino-obturator shelf. Now this shows on the right side the pectineal ligament where we are going to take sutures. You can see how clearly the cave of radius is exposed because of the Chernyi's incision. Now finger in the vagina elevates the vagina and you can see the bladder clearly. It is yellowish and lots of veins on it. Now this bladder has to be dissected medially using a fold gauze, taking care, utmost care, not to injure the vessels as much as possible. Now with the fold gauze I am dissecting the bladder medially. Automatically it gets dissected because the fingers in the left hand, they give counter traction. Now you can see clearly how the bladder is being dissected medially of the vagina. You can see big vessel, these are the bladder veins. As far as possible, injury should be avoided to them by gentle dissection. In case they get injured, using suction and fiber optic light source, you have to secure them with catgut. Now you see clearly how the vagina is being exposed. Identification is by the color change and by the firmness of the tissues of the vagina. There it goes. Complete exposure of the vagina from above. These veins, if they bleed, they bleed ferociously and they have to be properly underrun. Now you can see that the fingers meet. The finger in the vagina and the finger from above, they meet. And that again indicates that the dissection of the vagina is, dissection of the bladder is complete. Same step is repeated using number one proline, a mattress suture taking full thickness of the vagina and at least 1 centimeter of the length is taken. Again the level is the same, that is the bladder neck, that is Foley's balloon. Now in case you go through a vein, just tying the suture will achieve hemostasis. Now these proline sutures which go through the vaginal wall entirely do not give rise to any symptoms later on because epithelialization occurs over these sutures and therefore patient does not get any abnormal discharge. This mattress suture will be now tied using at least 3 to 4 firm knots. And now this suture has been passed through the pectineal ligament on the left side also. There it is on the left side. Once the both sides are complete, then the knots have to be tied, elevating the vagina, the lateral fornices of the vagina, to the pectineal ligament on that side. So this is how the knots are tied. Sutures will be tied on the right side of the patient now. Once that is done, now you see the bulb of the Foley's balloon that is moving. That is nothing but the bladder neck, and you can see clearly that the bladder neck has been elevated right behind the symphysis pubis. So this is the aim of Birch Kolbe suspension, elevating the bladder neck right behind the symphysis pubis. So that treats the bladder neck hypermobility. Now once that is done, the abdomen will be closed. Now this is an extraperitoneal operation, so there is no need to close the peritoneum. What you have to do is you take the recti which have been divided from the pimphysis pubis back to their original place. Now this is done either using Vicryl or catgut. Once the muscles are closed, the sheath is closed as routine. This is a case of uterine prolapse in a young patient. You can clearly see that it is a third degree uterovaginal prolapse with the uterus almost out of the introitus with cystocele, rectocele and enterocele. Now such young patients should not be treated with hysterectomy even if childbearing is over. Now what is done is a sling operation to correct the uterine prolapse. Now here extreme laxity of the uterosacrals and the mechanrods can be appreciated. The uterus can be pushed out completely and it can be pulled inside the abdomen, and that it comes almost out of the abdomen. So that shows the extreme laxity of these ligaments. Now to start with the procedure, peritoneum is incised on the anterior uterine wall just above the internal os. Now this is very important that finally the tape is fixed to the uterus and not to the cervix so that the uterus does not become retroverted. Peritoneum is dissected down and then Marcelin tape 30 centimeters long, 5 millimeter broad is fixed to the anterior wall of the uterus. Using a Mayo needle, adequate depth of the anterior uterine musculature is taken, and about 1 to 2 centimeters of the uterine wall should be included in the bite of the needle. You can see that it has gone adequately inside. That is why when you pull, a lot of force is required to take out the Marcelin tape. Once the Marcelin tape is taken out, then two ends are made equal, and then the tape is further fixed using 10 proline sutures on either side. First one goes through the anterior uterine wall, then one goes around the Marcelin tape on that side so that the tape is fixed firmly to the anterior uterine wall. This step is extremely important, and all the recurrences which occur are because of inadequate fixation of the tape to the anterior uterine wall, from where it gets avulsed later on, either normally or during the process of labor. Now this shows the fixation of the tape on the other side using 10 proline sutures, again going through the anterior wall of the uterus and then going around the tape and not through the tape. One must be careful not to injure the uterine arteries which are laterally located, so that they should not be injured during tape fixation. An additional central suture may be taken which further fixes the tape to the anterior uterine wall, making good amount of fibrosis, and this anchorage of the tape to the anterior uterine wall becomes excellent. Bladder need not be pushed down because the fixation of the tape is quite high up. The bladder does not come in the way. Only thing, you have to push the peritoneum down so that later on reperitonization can be done and the tape becomes totally extraperitoneal. Now you have the central portion of the tape fixed to the anterior uterine wall and two ends free. Now these two ends are brought in the cave of Regius, which has been opened by the incision, which is Czerny's incision, which gives adequate exposure to this cave of Regius. Now you can see that long artery forceps is being passed from the cave of Regius subperitoneally just below the round ligament. You can see clearly the round ligament, and then it is brought in the uterine peritoneal incision to catch that end of the tape. Again, one can easily appreciate that there is no important structure which comes in the way of passage of the artery forceps, making this technique extremely safe. Now this long artery forceps catches the other end of the tape on the left side, and then automatically the tape, this is the round ligament and that is the forceps parallel to the round ligament just below it, completely extraperitoneal. So the tape is fed into the artery forceps and the tape is withdrawn in the cave of Retzius. The same procedure has to be done on the right side, using again a long artery forceps from the cave of Retzius subperitoneally below the round ligaments to the incision on the uterine wall. This is on the right side. You can see the forceps long hemostat being passed below the round ligaments parallel to it and coming in the peritoneal incision which has been taken on the uterus. The importance of this technique is that one always dissects away from important structures like the ureter, rectosigmoid and the median sacral vessels which come in the way when one does a posterior sling operation. Thus, this procedure is much more simpler and very, very safe. It does not have any intraoperative or postoperative complications. Only the areolar tissue is there below the peritoneum, so that has to be pierced, and then the long artery forceps comes out in the incision of the peritoneum over the entry wall of the uterus. This will now grasp the other end of the tape which has been fixed in the center to the uterus, and then the tape will automatically be withdrawn in the cave of Retzius. Now both these ends have to be fixed to the pectineal ligaments on both sides. Pectineal ligaments are strong ligaments which are about 5 cm lateral to the pubic symphysis on the pelvic brim, and there is no major structure near the pectineal ligaments. Now this shows the tape has been threaded into a curved cutting Mayo's needle, and the needle is being passed through a good thickness or adequate thickness of the pectineal ligament on the left side. Now one appreciates the strength of these ligaments by the strength that is required to pull the needle out of the ligament. You can see that you have to use a lot of force to take the tape out of the pectineal ligament. That means these ligaments are not flimsy structure, they are very strong and hold the uterus properly in the position. Now the tape is out of the pectineal ligament on the left side. The same procedure is done on the right side. The tape is threaded into a Mayo needle and it goes on the right pectineal ligament, through the right pectineal ligament. Here the external iliac vessels are placed quite laterally, but you can see that there is a retractor, a right angle retractor protecting the iliac vessels. But one can see that one is operating quite away from the region of the external iliac vessels. Now once these two ends of the tape are taken in the cave of Retzius, the peritoneal incision is closed over the uterus, making the entire attachment of the tape to the uterus extraperitoneal, so that adhesions do not form in this area. The bladder is way down, so you don't have to worry about the bladder. Just close the peritoneum continuous locking sutures with 1-0 chromic catgut. Now once that is done, the step is that of fixing the Marcellin tape to the pectineal ligament. Now this is being done on the left side of the patient. What I have done is that passed a proline suture through the pectineal ligament and around the tape and fix it there. And now the tape is further fixed to the pectineal ligament by tying knots over itself. 2 to 3 knots are tied and thus the tape gets fixed to the pectineal ligament. Using proline number 10, one can further fix the knots. Now this again shows that when I am going through the pectineal ligament, again around the knots and tying it. The idea is to promote as much fibrosis as possible between the tape and the pectineal ligaments, just making this surgery very, very secure. Now since the weight of the uterus is shared by two strong ligamentous points in the form of pectineal ligaments, this tolerates the labor pains, or rather the labor that occurs, and therefore the rate of recurrence even after normal delivery is quite low. Now you can see from above the uterus, central portion, that is the part where the tape is fixed, and then the lateral parts. After this, what has been done here is the Moskowitz sutures, which have been taken because there was a big interosseal. So using 10 Vicryl, that is these purse string suture has been taken. Here one has to avoid the ureter, which is quite laterally placed. You can take 1, 2, or 3 concentric layers of the Moskowitz sutures, or one can take 1 Moskowitz followed by 2 or 3 Halban stitches. Halban is anterior-posterior closure of the pouch of Douglas. So this is the Moskowitz closure. Now this patient had multiple defects. It had a uterine prolapse because of laxity of the McEnroe uterosacral complex. Then she had big enterocele. She also has cystocele that has to be repaired from below. That is the standard anterior colporrhaphy. Now this shows the pouch of Douglas, which is totally obliterated. So enterocele has been taken care of. Thus, bilateral fixation of the uterus to the pectineal ligament gives excellent results so far as uterovaginal prolapse is concerned. This is the case of vaginal wall prolapse. Now, you can clearly see the version of the wall, that is the suture line. Anteriorly you see the cystocele part, and posteriorly there is rectocele part. So this is the failure at level 1, level 2 according to the Leland's classification. This is the abdominal repair of vaginal wall prolapse. Here using a Czerny incision, the cave of Rodgers has been opened. The vault has been pushed from below upwards. So that is the vault or the dome of the vagina.
Here
you see the bladder. And posterior is the pouch of Douglas. Now, the vaginal vault is held with two ellipsis forceps. This is the way it shows the laxity of the ligaments. Uterosacral and the cardinal ligaments are so lax that the entire vault comes out. Now the peritoneum over the vault is incised transversely, and using sharp dissection the bladder is slowly pushed down, so that later on when we take sutures over the vault, they do not damage the bladder in any way. So the bladder is pushed out of the harm's way. Similarly, if there are any other adhesions to the vault, they can disappear. The ovaries have to be removed, then the ovaries can be removed.
Push kar dega?
Now that is the peritoneum.
This we can close. This is the peritoneum which we can
cover later on. It is mandatory to dissect the
bladder.
Probably this is the only structure that comes close to the dissection when we do this particular procedure. Now using Marceline tape, 30 centimeters long, 5 millimeters.
Not much.
Right? The tape is fixed to the entire width of the wall, starting from one end. So in this case, I am going to use the right pectineal ligament for fixation. So I started fixing the wall from the left side, tying a knot, 2 to 3 knots of the tape, and then the remaining tape, about 4 to 5 centimeters of the tape, will be fixed to the entire width of the vault. Now here in this case, the vault is very broad. You can see it is almost 4 to 5 centimeters in breadth. So depending on that, you have to take 5 to 6 which goes through the entire dome of the vagina and around the mercury tape. So that the vault tape is fixed properly.
Epithelialization occurs over it.
Vagina wall. Alternatively, one can use proline mesh, cut the mesh into strips, and then one part of the mesh can be attached to the vault and the other end to the pectineal ligament. However, since the Mercilin tape has got excellent tensile strength, the results of vault suspension have been excellent without any recurrence so far.
Like 10 catgut.
So multiple sutures are taken.
A suture
fix the entire
10 catgut
width of the vaginal wall to the tape. Now, this tape is made extraperitoneal by covering the peritoneum that was dissected at the beginning of the surgery and suturing it back over the tape. Therefore, the tape does not get exposed to bowel, and there are no question of adhesion formation later on. One can clearly see that this procedure is very safe because the dissection is carried out in an area which is away from important structures like the ureter, rectosigmoid, median sacral vessels. Now, cave of Ridges is entered and a long artery forceps is passed from the cave of Ridges just below the peritoneum.
This then?
And then it is brought out
this then,
through the incision over the wall so as to grasp the other end of the tape and bring it in the retropubic space. Again, during this step, we are away from any important structure. The artery forceps is passed sub peritoneum. In case there is buttonholing of the peritoneum, that hole can be sutured later on. So with slow dissection using a tooth forceps and the long artery forceps, the tape will be grasped in the tip of the forceps and withdrawn into the cave of Ridges. The Mercilin tape is available in two forms. One is with needle, where there are two big strong needles on both ends of the tape. That is the one which is being used here. You can see that the needle is grasped in the artery forceps. The Mercilin tape comes without needles. One can use Mayo needle, called strong Mayo needle. That, with that needle, the tape can be passed on one side through the wall and the other side through the ligament.
These are all aerial tissues.
Now the tape is withdrawn in the cave of Ridges. Unlike uterine suspension, wall suspension is done unilaterally. The reason is that it is sufficient
to give equal
strength to the wall because the wall does not have weight like the uterus. So unilateral suspension is enough, and again it does not give rise to dyspareunia, though the wall is pulled on one side and does not remain exactly in the center. Now this step shows that the tape is being passed through the pectineal ligament. Pectineal ligament is a very strong ligament, about 5 to 6 centimeters, lateral to the symphysis. Now, once the tape is pulled adequately, the wall automatically gets lifted up to its normal position. Once the wall is lifted up to the pectineal ligament, the tape is first fixed using 10 proline. Now this proline is being passed again through the pectineal ligament, and then it is passed around the tape. It is never passed through the tape because that will weaken the tape. This is the preliminary fixing. fixation of the plate to the pectoral ligament using 1-0 pulling sutures. Once the plate is fixed in this manner, the tape is further fixed using knots of the tape itself so that further proper fixation of the tape to the pectoral ligament is assured. The external iliac vessels, they are quite laterally placed, so they cannot be injured. Other structures do not be injured. This becomes a bad blood loss. Now this part shows how the tape is fixed by using Now if there is entrocele addition, then rectocele has to be prepared for the patient. This is how two or three knots are taken of the tape itself. And this fixes the tape properly to the pectoral ligament, preventing any sort of recurrence. So two steps are important: fixation of the tape to the vault and fixation of the tape, other end of the tape, to the pectoral ligament. If there is little oozing from the cave of edges, one can keep from gel foam. There is no need to keep any drain in this space. Then the abdomen will be closed. So this step shows that the knots of the tape themselves are further fixed with the help of proline sutures to prevent loosening of the knots later on. So this is an additional step to promote fibrosis between the tape and the pectoral.